Very nice to meet you. Anybody that has Oren as an executive producer on a film, I must see their film and talk to them.
Thank you.
And boy, I'm glad I did, Niav. What a beautiful little film Small Time is.
Oh, thank you. I'm glad you liked it.
It is. I love the way you have styled this, your structure, the way you go back and forth with flashbacks. It's almost as if a memory sparks a strand, and we follow that strand for a while before something jolts Emma back into the present. It's really interesting the way you do that. And what you do visually to aid us in this memory recall, the cinematography, you have just blown my mind. The way that these flashbacks, they're bright. You've got yellow sun reflecting on Audrey Grace's gorgeous blonde hair, and blue skies and greenery. It's light, it's bright, it's alive, and it's vibrant, just like a child's memories are. It is just so exquisite to see that and to follow this little girl with such purity and eyes wide open while she's surrounded by what is a wonderful commentary on America as it really is. I just you've done an amazing job, Niav.
Thank you. I'm so glad that you, like, got all of that from the film. And it really was, like, the way it was pieced together and edited together in the end was very, you know, not story-based. It was very textural-based.
Yeah.
And, like, it sounds like that came through to you.
It's very sensory.
Yeah, yeah.
Very, well, very sensory. Yeah.
Of the nature of memory and childhood memory, you know, for me, it's all about the senses, because how much of actual events from childhood, you know, do we remember? We remember the flashes, the textures, the feelings, you know, but not necessarily so much all of the reality.
Yeah. And no, it's very, very true. And the fact that all it takes is one little thing, you know, going through the woods and coming upon a house that used to be her mother's house not too long ago. And then that sends us off on another memory sense that comes to life. And you do this, and it just is so beautiful. And I love how you counter this with her quote-unquote present day, depending on what the day is as time is passing. But you counter that with it's grayer, it's colder. There isn't really any warmth there. And you really feel the warmth that Emma gets are from those memories. The joy she gets is from those memories. When she really got to be a child. And I love the scene where you've got Rick taking her on the motorcycle and going to Dennis's place. I mean, he may be a screw-up, as everybody around her is, but the enchantment of her in the yard and discovering jewelry and little prismatic things, and then the kitten, it is just wide-eyed, total innocence, and is so unbelievably charming that beauty exists within the horrors of the drug-addled adults, and
yeah.
she is unjaded, and it's a beautiful scene. I think it's my favorite scene in the film.
Mm. Well, yeah, that's a large part of what I, you know, was setting out to do was to it's like become such a dark story, and there's so much darkness in it. But not to tell that story necessarily, to tell the story of whatever is happening through this innocent perspective. And, you know, that joyride on the bike is not like, we know there's not great things happening there. But for her, it's a lovely, fun adventure until she gets back and she realizes people are angry and she's not really sure why, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to make sure that there was that contradiction in there, that mm-hmm. this is a great day, this is a fun day, and she's enjoying discovering these things and doing this stuff, but there's also a lot of wrong things happening behind that feeling.
Mm-hmm. And when you, that particular scene, I really love what you do with Rick, with and Holter's performance, because he takes her on the ride knowing that that Jesse is, she's strung out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she's passed out. And he really does his best in throughout this film to shelter Emma from a bad impression. It's like, no, mom is sick, mom is sleeping, you know, and then he takes her on, it may, okay, he may be doing a drug run, but he takes her on the fun escapism and adventure. And he really does shield her from a lot. And I found that really interesting in your character construct. That he truly is trying to a degree, trying to help her and shield her from the horrid realization of who and what her mother is. And I love how that comes through, and so much of it is in Holter's performance. You did a wonderful job casting him on top of what you crafted.
Well, he manages to never go one way or the other, which is why I love what he did so much. You know, he's not a bad guy, but he's definitely also not a good guy. he has weak, bad instincts, and he has good, supportive instincts. And you never really know which one is going to win out, you know?
Mm-hmm. It's true. And that balance.
I guess at the end, he is the weaker one win, because that's less of a shielding thing that he does to center to the ice cream store.
Yeah, that was kind of, it wouldn't have been as bad if the pregnant strung out one on the floor hadn't done that incredible makeup job on her.
It all just doesn't, it's not a good, a lot of little details in there make it so that it's such a wrong.
Very wrong. You know, Niamh, this is such a unique perspective for a story with unique characters that we don't see that often. The truthfulness of them, the unvarnished truth. What was the germ of this idea? What was the impetus for this story and your process in developing each of these characters? Because the characters are so significant. Nobody is really peripheral. And you show us that with each one, be it, you know, with Lonnie, who totally creeps me out, and I kept thinking the whole film he's a pedophile. that was just, oh my God. But then you get the heart and the fun and even a protective nature of somebody like, I think, Jason Gretkowski's character. Big, burly, you know, bearded guy, but boy, he's teaching Emma how to shoot. But, you know, he's doing it in a fun way, and he's getting her outside. And he's still being very protective in how he's showing her and holding her. And he puts his hands over her ears so they don't get hurt with the blast. Really sweet little touches that we get a humanity. We see there is a humanity in each of these people.
Well, the where we shot it is very much of a heavily in Pennsylvania. It's a rural area of Pennsylvania. It's heavily Trump. It's very, very gun-based. It's, you know, all of these things, it's opioid problematic. All of these things that are in the film are part of that place. But having spent quite a bit of time there, you know, my instinct is to be horrified by by giving kids shooting lessons.
Mm-hmm.
But out there, that's a very normal thing.
Yep.
So you're kind of, the more local people I met, and I lived there part of the time. So, you know, I can get to know them pretty well, is you realize that this is not like this idea of badness to do such a thing. You know, for them, it's a family values thing, you know? So, that's part of my responsibility in bringing the characters of the area and that world in, is making sure that I'm not judging them from my limited perspective, but I'm just allowing them to do what they do, and for the reasons that they do it, which are not necessarily bad. And also, you know, just falling into addiction. This country tends to blame addicts for all of these things, but as we know, a lot of it is you know, they are the victims of a pharmaceutical situation that is entirely criminal. And so, sure, they're behaving weakly, you know, in weakness, and doing really not good things, but they are on their own struggle. You know, they're struggling through whatever they are struggling through, each one of them, to come out, you know, come out somehow from it. And everyone is in the film. But the film began as a short film, and the short was the earliest part, where she goes on the motorcycle ride and steals a kitten and comes back, and so that section. So I just shot the short, and it was supposed to be a short. I didn't intend to create a feature, but then there was, I felt like all of the characters were so interesting, and they had so much more that I wanted to discover with them, and there was just a nice vibe with everyone. So that's when I realized maybe this could become a feature, and the short could be incorporated in to allow, like, time between each section for Audrey to grow up a little bit more in real life as well as in the film. And so that's how it kind of developed.
Now, once you decided you were going to do a feature, was it always your intent to direct that, to shoot it, to be acted cinematographer, to shoot it, and also to edit? Or was this
the short I didn't want to DP. I wanted to find someone else, and I had found someone who I thought would be really good for this particular project. And they had to pull out at the last minute. This is a very, very low-budget film. So, you know, everyone has their reasons for not being able to, you know, follow through at times. And I couldn't really find someone else that I felt had the right qualities. So it was getting time to shoot it. I decided just to shoot it myself. And I'm glad I did, and I was a little scared to do so because it was Audrey's very, very first film ever. So she was 7 years old and had never acted before. And I, you know, auditioned her, and I had this feeling just that she could be there, you know, be as present as she was. And, but I, you know, of course, shooting it and directing it and writing it and all that stuff is a little bit much with a seven-year-old first-time actor. So I was a little nervous about that, but it ended up being a good thing, I think, because she developed a relationship with the camera at the same time as she did so with me.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, an actor is always, I think, negotiating their relationship with a camera. And especially for a very, very young actress starting out, that's an important thing to start to kind of feel and figure out what that is.
Oh, absolutely.
And because I was behind the camera, and much of it was handheld, so literally I was the camera, and talked to her a lot during the shots and would just kind of guide her through what to do. So it became like this, she became aware of the camera while knowing that she couldn't look there in an interesting way. And so I think it helped a lot. And so that's why I just continued for the feature.
Mm-hmm.
We had already kind of developed that relationship, so it seemed like the right thing to do to continue it.
I think it worked beautifully for you. In the end product, I think it worked very well for you. That relationship that you got to develop with her and the camera, mm-hmm, at the same time. Because she has no fear.
Mm-hmm.
First time actor at 7 years old, they're going to have some trepidation and look a little fearful. She, mm-hmm, doesn't. And that just adds so much to your POV with her innocence and her wide-eyed, unjaded look at the world.
And yeah, I think she was developing a relationship with the camera as human rather than the camera as machine.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
And what you also do so keenly, oh, thank you for doing this too, you tell us this, you keep us in Emma's POV with the camera itself. You have us, the camera is eye level with Emma. You're dutching upwards so that we get the perspective. She's looking up at a very tall Rick, or she's looking down, or she's laying in the church pew looking up, or everything stays in her POV. And where you have face-to-face between her and another character, they're sitting together. Or you pull out wider, such as Lonnie walking her to school. And you pull out wider so it looks more of an even plane. You don't zoom in. I really so appreciate you keeping us in Emma's POV from a physical standpoint. It really draws us in to this world and her soul. It works so,
yeah,
well. So beautifully done.
Yeah.
Because you're also editing, you're a co-editor on this one. Were you editing as you went, especially since you had time, you allowed yourself time in between shooting segments so that Audrey could grow? Did you edit, or did you wait till you had amassed all the footage? What was that process like for you?
Right. So, well, Joyride was its own little short.
Mm-hmm.
So I edited that. And then when we decided to do the feature, I brought Babak on, who's a really wonderful, intuitive editor. And it was kind of part by part. So part two is the winter part. I wrote that. We shot it. And he edited it.
Mm-hmm.
And only after part two was done shooting did I start to write part three.
Mm-hmm.
So I had some ideas where maybe I wanted things to go, but a lot of those ideas totally changed based on what the actors did with their characters in part two. So it wasn't really like a story that was ever going to happen.
Right.
It was more of a following these characters where they were kind of deciding to go, you know, and really reacting to what the actors brought. Like Lonnie's character was really only started out as this guy in part two. And he had that one scene, and I wanted him to be the dad, but just, you know, this guy that we never actually know that is the dad, we kind of maybe suspect.
Mm-hmm.
But he brought such an interesting thing to the role, and he ended up being a character I really wanted to see more of. So then, you know, part three then ended up being quite centered on him.
Mm-hmm.
So it was kind of like following breadcrumbs through through the forest, you know, not a plan laid out, but you're kind of following where things go. And then once we shot part three, then that was edited by Babak. And only at the end was the idea of kind of puzzling them all together.
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, I thought it was going to be just laid 1, 2, 3. Naively, I don't know what I was thinking, but I thought it would work like that, and it didn't work like that. And then I realized, okay, now I have to start piecing these things together and find moments. And that was a really fun part of the editing for me, was finding the moments that would cut to another moment for whatever reason.
Mm-hmm. Oh my God. I can just imagine. I can just imagine. I like the idea that you thought it was just going to, oh, 1, 2, 3. They just go right together. I love that. Okay. You were looking at the editing with your own bit of Emma and her wide-eyed innocence.
Exactly.
Oh my gosh. Well, you know, hand in hand with the editing process so often is the score, is the music. And I'm really curious about what you were looking for musically. Something very interesting that John did, your composer, when we go to the flashbacks, there's a musical motif in there that it sounds more like an electronic sound effect with each flashback. And I just thought that was really interesting to hear that and have that also be an indicator, a subconscious indicator, more or less, that, okay, we're back. We're going back to a happy, happy moment. But I'm curious what your thoughts were, what you were looking for musically. And once you had that, did that aid you in your editing? Or did you have to do all the editing first and then have John go do the music?
I think they kind of developed hand in hand, but because each part was edited separately, so then once each part was edited and the short, of course, was finished and went to festivals and did its whole thing before it was kind of chopped up and then put into the feature. So that music was composed for that part, which is, I think, why you're saying it's, you know, it feels like its own style of music a little bit. And so each part, like after part two was assembled, then we discussed with John what kind of music would work well for that. And that's, of course, quite a bit darker and more edgy. Whereas the part one is kind of this euphoric electronica, I would say, like a childlike euphoria with an electronic twist. And then part three was, you know, after it was kind of all put together, then whatever came out of part three happened. So it was very much section conceived musically. Mm-hmm. But I would say, like, what we were really trying to do with the music, and what I love that he, I think he pulled it off so well, is that the music is always trying to support the emotion of a moment, mm-hmm. not our emotion, the spectator's emotion.
But Emma's, or yeah,
the emotion of the character.
Yeah.
So it is not adamantly not meant to guide our experience, which is, I think, what a lot of movie music does.
Mm-hmm.
And I always find it kind of obnoxious, and I don't like having that feeling that the music is manipulating my experience,
mm-hmm.
and telling me, like, now this is sad. Now this is a dramatic moment, you know?
Yeah.
So it just stays with whatever the character is feeling, and then we can join them however we join them,
mm-hmm.
without being told how we should feel about it.
Yeah, no, the music definitely, it follows rather than leads.
Mm-hmm.
And that is so important, because, yes, like you, it does annoy me when I get a musical cue and it's telling me, it has the scary, you know, the horror music. Oh,
right.
Something's coming out of the closet. You know, oh, there's gonna be an accident here. Somebody's gonna die. Yeah. So I love it when the music, when the score is, it serves as an undercurrent, and it mm-hmm. buoys the emotion rather than telling us what we are supposed to feel. So, yeah, it works really good. All the pieces of this puzzle fit together so well, Niav. But I've got to ask you, you know, this is a huge undertaking. You go from doing a short to writing, directing, DPing, editing, the feature. What was this learning curve like? Because you're no stranger to film. I mean, you've been making films, you've been working as a DP, you've done all kinds of shorts, but this is, it's a big enough leap going into a feature. But here you are wearing, and the producer's hat, so you have all of these hats on your head. What was this learning curve like, and were your hats in conflict with each other throughout this process?
I think the learning curve was more about stamina for me, because it was over, I guess, you know, if we include after going to festivals and everything, 6 years getting it finalized, it's hard to stay with it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, at a certain point, you just can't look at it anymore. And I love it. I love the film, but I sometimes, you know, seeing parts of it just makes me a little nauseous. I've just seen it too much. You know? So that, I think, is a portion, like, yeah, it's for me, the main learning curve is stamina. And also, like, I really appreciate you loving the fact that it did remain in her perspective, like, over all of these parts, just reminding myself that this is a story from this girl's perspective, wherever mm-hmm. she is now at. Because it's, you know, it could be easy to just start telling the story, but that's not what it's about. It's about this particular story through her eyes, and it's a totally different story that way.
Mm-hmm.
So creatively, kind of like keeping myself in that mindset was important as well. But I mean, honestly, I think, like, I was co-producer, but John, the composer, is also the main producer.
Mm-hmm.
And like, it just wouldn't have ever happened without him. because he provided, like, it's a very, very low-budget film, and he lives there and has a business there that kind of gave us everything that we needed and has a lot of connections to the area because he grew up there, so we got all of the locations for free.
Oh, wow.
It was church, school, Dandy's, mini mart, all of it.
Wow.
Because he knows these people. You know, so I think the reason why it could happen is because he was there kind of always pushing it forward and supporting, you know, given that I had all of these roles, just supporting me kind of there saying, whatever we need, we'll find it, you know? We mm-hmm. may not have the money for it, but we'll find a way mm-hmm. to get it. And so, yeah, I don't know. I guess the learning curve is mainly just that, is mm-hmm. like, is sticking with it.
Well, I'm glad you
not losing hope.
I'm glad you stuck with it and you didn't give up on it. Through it all, we get so much innocent humor in here as well. You have some of the funniest lines in here. You know, when Emma's talking about with her little friend, her little Muslim friend in school, about they're having their own religious conversation between Muslim and Christianity, and mm-hmm. Muslims can't eat bacon. And I don't know why. And, well, we eat the body of Christ and the blood of Christ, and his blood does not taste good. I'm glad I wasn't drinking anything, because I probably would have spit it at the screen, because I was laughing so hard. All of these conversations and questions that Emma has are so pure and so true, and that is the heart of this film, Yev. That is truly the heart of this film, is the innocence and purity of the child, and how the child is absorbing and looking at this world around her and asking the questions that none of these folks have answers to.
Right, exactly. Thank you for seeing that. Because it's not like some people, you know, it's too dark for them, or they're like a harrowing tale, there's no hope here. I really don't believe that at all.
I don't see this as a harrowing tale at all.
Very opposite, yeah.
Yeah, no,
like
this
we're looking at dark subjects, but with a lot of humor and innocence, and like putting, as you say, putting those questions that all of the adults stopped asking so many years ago.
Yeah.
About their reality.
The whole drug scene and cooking and, you know, making cookies, not understanding. So she doesn't get drugged down by the world around her. I can't tell you how many times as a kid, how do you open a can of soup when you cannot find a can opener? Yes, you naturally think, oh, I'll get a knife. It cuts things.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't really cut through the soup can, though. You learn that very quickly as a kid. So,
right.
But all of these little gems, all these little nuggets you have, you just, they are so beautiful to see. And as I said, that is the heart of this film. You've done a wonderful, wonderful job as a storyteller here. You really have. And I can't wait to see what you do next.
Well, I've got another one in post.
Now, are you wearing, how many hats are you wearing with this, with the new one?
The new one is a pandemic one.
Oh, God.
So very, very, very pared down. And unfortunately, I'm wearing more hats than even the first one.
Oh, my God. Oh, my. How many more hats are there? Are you doing costume and set design?
But it's a much simpler story. There's two characters, you know. It's more handleable. It's called Person, Woman, Man, Camera, TV. And it is in the final stages of post right now.
Now, will that be going out on the fest circuit, or do you have a
Yeah.
distribution on that already?
No, it'll be going to festivals and then we'll see what happens from that.
Oh, wonderful. Wonderful. Well, I can't wait to see it, especially with you wearing even more hats. I must see it. I must see it. Oh, I can't thank you enough. This has been really wonderful getting to talk to you about this film.
Well, thank you so much for talking to me. I really appreciate it, and for watching and receiving the film so attentively and like in the right way.
Oh, I look forward to your next one, and I look forward to talking to you again, too.
Okay, thank you so much, Debbie.